Sai Ram to everybody. Bhagavan speaks to students and staff in the evenings every day after completing the regular interview sessions. Bhagavan is so gracious that he spends an hour, sometimes 1.5 hours, with students and teachers there in Sai Kulwant Hall. We see Bhagavan sitting on the chair, surrounded by students and teachers. One thing is this, it is not possible for all the devotees to hear what Swami speaks there, because there is no public address system. Second thing is, it is usual or casual conversation. But during conversation, we find certain pearls of wisdom. And these pearls of wisdom will be of immense benefit to all Sai devotees. Keeping this in our view, I thought of writing down on paper. And Sanatana Sarathi, in Telugu edition, in Telugu version, has been publishing all talks of Bhagavan, informal talks with students and teachers for the last 27 issues. Yes, 2 years and 3 months. Then I thought it is necessary for English listeners also, English knowing listeners also, to know what Swami speaks to students. And I collected them date-wise, gave them some headings also. I am so glad that all of you have arranged and planned to see that these things are conveyed to Sai devotees in different languages. May Baba bless you. I am sure the Sai devotees from all over the world in different languages will be immensely thankful and grateful to you, because these things are not available to general devotees. These are all the points collected from his conversations with students and teachers. Hence, these precious, most valuable Sai pearls of wisdom we may start sharing with the devotees as our responsibility and as a sacred duty, not only for the present and also for the benefit of the posterity. May Bhagavan bless you in this attempt, in this endeavor, and I am also sure that you will be encouraged to proceed further and further in the years to come in this line of activity. And your suggestions and comments for the improvement are most welcome. Thank you. Sai Ram. Well, to make it updated is very difficult. As I said, that this I have been doing for the last 27 months or even little more. So I will go from the reverse order. From the reverse order. This had happened on 5th of October. 5th of October. Bhagavan granted interview to a group of foreigners and came out of the interview room gently, slowly, majestically, with a smiling face, adjusting the hair with another hand, walked towards us and stood in front of us and looked straight into my eyes and said, "Did you notice those foreigners?" I said, "No, Swami." "He is ambassador from Soviet Russia. He came along with two of his secretaries and stenographer. I spoke with them. I spent long time. They are very much surprised that there in the interview they asked, 'Swami, how do you know these things? You are speaking so many intimate things, so many things that are not known to many people. How do you know? It is amazing that you also speak Russian language. How do you know?'" And Bhagavan said, "These things are not learnt. These things are not taught. I am born with this. I am born with this." My friends, this punchline, we can take it as Sai pearls of wisdom. Avatar is born with these capacities, with these abilities. The omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent nature. They are not cultivated. They are not learned. They are not practiced. Is born with it. That comment Swami made, and everybody were very much surprised. And this happened on the 1st of October. As I said, I am proceeding in the reverse line to keep you updated, at least from this line of proceedings. This happened on the 1st of October. This has got something of general importance. He was talking with the PhD boys. We have six students working for their doctorate program in the Department of Management. Swami was talking to them. Suddenly asked one boy, "What is conscious?" The boy said, "I don't know." "You are a PhD boy. Don't you know conscious?" "Well, I don't know, Swami." He asked another professor, "What is conscience?" "Swami, conscience? Inner voice." "No, no, you are wrong." Then he asked another senior boy, PhD student, "What is consciousness?" "Swami, I don't know." And Swami said, "Look here, conscious is mind. Conscious is our mind. It is the mind that thinks. It is the mind that feels. It is the mind that reacts, that responds, that pulsates, that vibrates. So conscious meaning mind." Then Bhagavan went on to say, "Conscience is the intellect. Conscience is the intellect. Why? Conscience is very close to the spirit, is very close to the soul, is very close to Atma. Spirit or soul or Atma are one and the same. So intellect is very close to Atma. This intellect is symbolized. This intellect is conveyed, is expressed by this word conscience." Then Bhagavan said, "Then what is consciousness?" "This consciousness is the soul, is Atma, which is all pervading, which is encased within the body, yet present everywhere. It is within the body and present everywhere. How? Air is present within the balloon. Air is present within the cycle tire. Air is present within the car tire. Yet air is present all around. Like that, the spirit or Atma is present within everybody and present all over. So these three words indicate three levels of awareness, three levels of consciousness, three levels of experience, three levels of comprehension, three levels of understanding, which we reach out along the path of intensive sadhana or spiritual pursuit. We should not stop at a particular level. Conscious being the mind, if you stop at the level of the mind, we are only emotional, we are only passionate, we are bestial, we are more animal minded. If we stop at the level of the conscience, intellect, we are rather intelligent, self-introspective, self-evaluating, self-assessing. In other words, we stop at the level of the self-enquiry. We should not discontinue. We should still proceed further, reach the state of consciousness, the ultimate, the reality, Atma, or the soul, or the spirit, the real self, the cosmic self, which is the universal self, as Bhagavan has put it. And Bhagavan said, laughing, today you boys, you want to understand these things, but the modern boys don't understand. They know only misunderstanding. They have no idea of understanding. And then I have put a question to Swami. Bhagavan, yes, my friends, here I want to inform you, when there is enough of time, when Swami is in a very good mood, we can ask any number of questions without hiding, without reservation. Well, I thought of putting this question, Bhagavan, what is the difference between inert matter, inert matter and consciousness or Atma or energy? What is the difference between inert matter and consciousness? Bhagavan just turned to me and said, there is no inert matter. Swami, there is no inert matter? What is all this? This is inert. What is this floor? Inert. What are the walls? Inert. Body? Inert. But the spirit is active. Spirit is consciousness. Spirit is awareness. Spirit is energy. And you say, there is no matter? There is no inert matter? Swami said, no. There is no matter at all. I see, Swami. How? Bhagavan said, only energy is present. Energy gets transformed into matter. Matter can be transformed back to energy. Energy and matter are one and the same. They are reversible processes, matter becomes energy, energy becomes matter. Moreover, matter is composed of atoms and molecules that consist of electrons, protons, neutrons that revolve with full energy. So how do you call it inert? When electrons, neutrons, microparticles move with terrific energy, how do you call it inert? Inert. So there is nothing like inert matter. Everything is divine. That divine, you can call it cosmic energy or consciousness, which is a matter of revelation to all of us. And then he said, look here, Anil Kumar, what you say is the proof of present day confusion. Our boys represent misunderstanding while you exhibit confusion. And today, the modern education is nothing but confusion and misunderstanding. Well, I was rather so happy, because to be corrected by Bhagavan, to be commented upon by Avatar, is also a privilege. It is a way of blessing. If I am an instrument to receive matter, to spread message to everybody, I love to be corrected. I love to be chided. I welcome admonition. So I liked everybody joined that peals of laughter that evening. Immediately Swami got up from his chair and about to move towards bhajan hall. There he stopped. Come on, he said. You must be watching that. I got up, went close to him. He asked one man, bring that bag. One boy brought some polythene bag. He asked me, what is that bag? Swami, some stones I see. What stones? Swami, stones of this size, big size. Where are they? Swami, I don't know. They are the stones which are recovered from the kidneys of our student. A student was operated upon recently, and that heavy stones were recovered from his kidneys. I was shocked. Swami, so big. Yes. You must have seen there. I was watching all the time. And suddenly Swami said, Dr. Bhatt, the sweet melodious voice. There comes Dr. Bhatt, 83-year-old man, 83, well-built, hefty personality, and he is called father of urology. Father of urology, meaning the branch of, father of nephrology. Nephrology, father of nephrology, meaning expert in kidneys science. He served there in Philomena Hospital, Bangalore. He also served as professor head of the department nephrology, Vellore Christian College, Medical College. Very top man. And he came. Anil Kumar, you know him? Swami, I know Dr. Bhatt. An old devotee of Bhagavan. I see Swami. He only did operation this morning. Swami, 83-year-old doctor. Yes. Those who are with Swami are never old. Those with Swami, they are never old, they are ever young. Oh, everybody laughed. And then he said, Bhatra, you did operate? Yes, Swami. Then Swami looked at me and said, you see, at this old age, he is doing such a tremendous work in our hospital. Very good devotee. Then doctor, but with folded hands, said, Swami, there is an American doll. The doll goes on playing. How does it play? When you give the key to the doll, it goes on playing. I am only a doll in your hands, Swami. You are the key and the key man behind this dancing doll. Immediately I caught hold of both of his hands, said, sir, you are Baba's gift to Sai devotees and a person of inspiration to all of us. This I thought worth sharing with you all. Well, this happened on 30th September this year, 2002. Well, Bhagavan, we understand that he has so many cars, and we also find Swami has so many comforts and conveniences. That's what we think and what we see and what we say. But this is the remark of Bhagavan. Anil Kumar, look here. I am never comfortable with these conveniences. I don't want these comforts and conveniences. Devotees force me to accept these things. What can I do? They go on crying. They go on crying until they are brought here. You see? They also got a lift for me there inside. I want to walk. What to do? I like to walk, but they just brought down lift there. I don't want these conveniences. My friends, because we are human, we think that God also needs comforts and conveniences. As human beings, we want conveniences. With this feeling, we think God also wants them. But here Bhagavan clearly said, I don't want. I feel very comfortable being just average and normal. That's what we said. And that evening, here is a joke. Primary school boys speak to Swami, so nice to watch. And little boy, boy, where do you come from? That boy immediately says, Swami, I come from you, Swami. Oh. Then he will turn to big boys and say, see, he says, from you, Swami. Whereas you fellows, from Bombay, from Chennai, see those boys. And then you'll ask another little boy, how old are you? Swami, 8 years. How do you know? My mother told me, Swami. Correct answer. And where are you fellows? How old are you? 20 years. How do you know? Date of birth certificate. See, what nice answer. He laughs like that. So big boys wanted to copy them. Copy. So that Swami will appreciate. And he asked one big boy. Big boy, I mean, postgraduate student. Hey, where do you come from? In Telugu, he asked this question. In Telugu. That boy said, I come from you, Swami. Imitating primary school boy. Swami immediately said, oh, from me. Then you must be knowing Telugu. If you are from me, why don't you know Telugu? Because that fellow could not give answer. Where do you come from? He could not answer. Why don't you give answer? I don't know. You say from me, then you must be knowing Telugu. So it's a big joke. But at the same time, a hint that we should never imitate, that we should never copy. long time back Bhagavan said, imitation is human, creation is divine. We are basically divine. We don't have to imitate. And when we imitate, we lose our originality. We lose our nature. We lose our identity. So let us be creative by being original, a lesson to everybody. This happened on 29th of September. One boy came close to Swami, and suddenly he came to Swami with folded hands and said, "Swami, please touch me here, please touch me here." "Why?" Swami said, "Why?" "Swami, swelling here, I am suffering from mumps, very painful, please touch." "Why should I touch? Go to the hospital." "No, no, Swami, if you touch, it will be cured." "Do you have faith in that?" "Swami, I have 100% faith." "Oh, I see." Swami just touched gently on that swollen part. Believe me, by the end of bhajans, no pain at all. The whole swelling subsided there only. This is a miracle, that the touch of Bhagavan is a guarantee for cure, a total cure. That's what I witnessed, what all of us witnessed that pleasant evening. Well, this happened on the 27th of September 2002. Swami suddenly came out with a cover, envelope, moving like that. What is this cover? That is a cover only, Swami. How do I know? He opened that cover. Count, calculate and tell me. I am very poor in mathematics. So I went on counting. You are a big professor, you don't know. Numbers also you don't know. Somehow, because I cannot go wrong, boys are there, they may laugh. So, with double care I said, Swami, 2 crores of rupees. It is a check presented by Italian to Swami, 2 crores of rupees. Swami said, I don't want this. I want your love, not your money. I want your love. Immediately he said, he called one Italian by name. I don't remember his name. That man came. You must be watching him. That man came and sat in the veranda. You must have seen him. Of course, dates you must have forgotten. What is that check? 2 crores to Swami. I don't want to take it back. I don't want your money. I want you. I want your love, my friends. It is amazing. It is unbelievable. It happens only with Bhagavan Sri Sat Sai Baba, nobody else. There are so many gurus all over the world who are money-minded. Here is Guru of Gurus, the teacher of teachers, avatar, who doesn't care for your money. 2 hoots after all. Why? God is wealth. Wealth is God. A beggar should ask for money. Man should ask for money. God need not ask for money. Because God is wealth, wealth is God. He is the very personification of all plenty and prosperity. Why should he ask anybody? This is a lesson to everybody that you cannot buy him, that your fabulous amounts will never influence him. That he doesn't expect any money from us, that he wants us being his children. He wants our love, nothing else. This is very, very surprising. Then he said, it seems this Italian was given an interview along with his wife, and there in the interview room another boy was also called in. That boy acted in a television serial by name Shirdi Parthi Sai. That little boy played the role of Sat Sai Baba. Swami called that boy and introduce that boy to everybody there in the interview room. At the end, Baba was telling us, at the end, the wife of this Italian gentleman was speaking to her husband. What did she say? Look here, why can't we adopt this boy? To Italy. I'll stay here for some more time with this boy and come there. Bhagavan said, that love for Swami is so deep because this boy played the role of Satchai Baba. They feel like taking to Italy, thinking that they are taking Satchai Baba with them. That is the love, intensity of devotion of that Italian couple. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then he was speaking about one gentleman who had two wives. He has two wives. Of course, first wife is no more, and somehow he's managing with the second. Now, Swami started joking. You know, he has two wives. Oh, Swami, two wives? Yes. Then Swami said, no, no, no. First wife is no longer there. She passed away. Oh. Then Swami said, what will happen to a fellow with two wives? Then I said, Swami, man is struggling hard, breathless with one wife, almost suffocating. With two wives, the deadline is already given, finished. Only date of expiry must be given. I don't know how the fellow is managing two wives. Swami laughed. And then he said, in Puranas are epics, a story of a king by name Uttanapada has two wives. One is Suruchi, another is Suniti. And one wife has a son by name Dhruva. That little boy wanted to sit on the lap of the father, but the stepmother did not permit. You cannot sit, get out, she said. Boy said, Mommy, I want to sit. No, get out. That boy left home, told all this to his mother. Mother, look here. Stepmother did not permit me to sit on the lap of the father. I cannot bear this suffering. The boy went all alone to the forest, did penance for a long time. God incarnated in front of him, granted all boons, and finally he remained. He is there today in the form of a star by name Dhruva. Dhruva is the name of a star. Right now we find there in the sky. And Bhagavan said, because of two wives, the father could not give love to both of his sons. When one son is enjoying love, the other fellow was started crying. When one fellow started receiving love, the stepmother, the second wife of the king, started fighting. This is the fate, you know. And then he said, Anil Kumar, do you know the name of a king who had three wives? Shall I say, I know? Then he may say, so you are collecting the names of the people with the number of wives? If I say, I don't know, he may say, don't you know that much? Then Swami immediately said, yes, he is Dasharatha, the father of Rama. Dasharatha has three wives, Kausalya, Sumitra, Kaikeyi. Because of the youngest wife, Kaikeyi, father Dasharatha had to suffer from the pain due to the pangs of separation from Rama. Rama had to be sent to the exile because of boons granted to Kaikeyi. The story is known to you. and ultimately the separation led to the death of Dasharatha. So the king of three wives had separation from his son and ultimately had to face even death. That's what Bhagavan has said. And finally, that's not be all and end all. It doesn't end with the narration or description of a story. Bhagavan is a good storyteller with message behind, with universal message behind. He said, look here, all of you, everyone of you here has 10 wives. Are Swami, with two wives that king suffered, with three wives that king died, with 10 wives how can we manage? Then Swami said, 10 wives are your senses. Senses of action are 5, senses of perception are 5, 5 plus 5, 10 senses. You have 10 wives. Oh. Okay, Swami, am I going to live or die? With the 10 wives, my senses, am I going to be alive? Who is the husband here managing with these 10 wives? Swami said, your mind is the master. Your mind is the husband of these 10 senses. So your mind, the husband, the master, has a total control over the senses. He will have a happy, peaceful, married life. But if your mind husband becomes a slave to his wives, the 10 senses, he has to dance to their tunes and ultimately commit suicide. So the lesson here is, the mind should be the master of the senses. Master the mind and be a master mind is the punchline, is the message of that afternoon's conversation with Bhagavan. Happened on the 25th of September 2002. We are quite lucky enough to have many, many spiritual points mentioned in the conversation with Swami. As usual, after completing the interviews, he sat there staring at everybody, collecting letters from all boys. Oh, they all formed into a bee line, giving letters one after one. The kind, merciful Bhagavan received letters from everybody almost, and then sat there. And then Swami started conversing with us. He said, what is society? Society. Society in Sanskrit is samaja. Samaja. Bhagavan has put this question to me. What is samaja? Society. I said, Swami, group of individuals. Bhagavan said, no, I'm always prepared for that kind of answer, replies from Swami. Because I prefer even to give wrong answers because we can get more information from Bhagavan. It is also sometimes a spiritual strategy or religious manipulation. You see, or human managerial technique. He can con it anyway. So I said, group of individuals, no, no. Swami said, the very meaning of that word samaja means equality. Sama, equal. Ja, born out of. Sama, equal, equality. Ja, born out of. So samaja meaning which is born out of equality, which is equal-minded, which is equanimous, where there is equality. How do you say group of individuals? Then I said, Swami, then what is the difference between the individual and society? Bhagavan said, individual is always selfish. Individual always has self-interest. Individual always aims at esteem, name, fame, popularity. So, individual is different. Individual is self-centered. Oh, Swami, then society? No, society thinks of creation. Society thinks of creation, which is of larger dimension. Oh, then Swami, creation thinks of what? Bhagavan said, creation thinks of creator. So, individual, that leads to community, and that community or society thinks of the creation, and the creation thinks of the creator. Bhagavan, ah, Swami, what a scientific explanation it is. Then Swami used four important technical Sanskrit terms, which will be of some interest to you. What else? The first word is vyasti. Vyasti, meaning individual. Second word, samashti. Samashti, meaning community. Third word, srishti. Srishti, creation. Fourth word, parameshti, creator or God. These four words Swami used. Vyashti, samashti, srishti, parameshti. Now, how he established connection or a sequence between these four levels. Bhagavan said, Vyasti, the individual, is self-centered. While Samasti, or society, always aims at equality, Samatva. In so doing, Samatva, equality, this Samasti, community, always thinks of creation, srishti. And this creation, srishti, wants to know parameshti, the creator. So one takes to the other in a perfect sequential, preferential order. Swami, what an explanation it is. Simple question, Swami, if you permit me. Swami, when the individual is self-centered, how to establish equality in community? How to establish equality in society? When the individual is self-centered, is that possible? That's my question. Then Bhagavan said, equality is not a political slogan. Equality is not similarity, is not anything to be identical. What is to be united here? Not ideological unity, not political unity. No, no, no. What is unity here? All our hearts should be united. All our hearts should be unified. So the unification of our hearts, the harmony of our hearts, only confers, only grants unity, that is samatva, equality, nothing else, Bhagavan has said. Today, my friends, we don't have ideal society today anywhere in the world because our hearts are not yet unified. Our hearts are not functioning in perfect harmony. So we are disunited. That's what Bhagavan has said. Swami, how to bring about harmony in our hearts? How to establish unity? How? Bhagavan said it's very easy. Swami, is it very easy? Yes, why not? Then Swami said, look here, you love your wife, you love your children, you love your friends, you love your relatives. Are you not linked with so many people? Are you not connected with different people? You are connected with different people. You are in perfect union with other people by the bond of love. And if this love is further expanded, if this love is further and further broadened, our hearts can easily be united. Our hearts can be unified. Our hearts can function in perfect harmony. That's what Bhagavan has said. This happened on 22nd September. Swami sat there, relaxed, watching so many devotees, waving his hand, giving them a blessing, exchanging smiles with students. He called one boy. Come here, he said. That boy is a student of MBA class, Master of Business Management. He hails from Hyderabad, the capital city of the state of Andhra Pradesh in India. He called him. MBA boy? He said, yes, Swami, I'm MBA. You are from Hyderabad? Yes, Swami, I'm Hyderabad. Then he looked at us and said, you know, before joining MBA program, he has been visiting this place for 5 years and prayed to Swami that he should get admission here in our university. So you see him here. Oh, Swami, is that so? Yes. And then he said, looking at boys, boys, you think that I am not talking to you. You think that I don't know you. I know everybody. I may not talking to you, but I know everyone. I know everything of everybody. I don't have to talk to you. Look here, I know about this boy. Then is it not enough for you to know that I know you also? Is it not enough? I know everybody. And then he said, Five days back, your friends from Hyderabad came here. Is it not? He said, yes, Swami. You spent some time with them also. Yes, Swami. They spoke to you. Yes, Swami. Where am I? I am everywhere. What did they talk to you? What did they tell you? Swami, everything okay. No, no, no. Shall I tell you? Nothing exceptional, Swami. No, no. Did they not ask you why Swami is not talking to you? Did they not inquire what Swami speaks to students every day? Swami, yes. Then why don't you tell me? I know. Why don't you tell that I know? Then Swami said, shall I tell you who came to see you? One fellow's brother is sick. How is he now? Swami, he is all right. Why don't you tell me? One fellow is searching for a job. Oh, he'll be getting appointment orders tomorrow. Did he tell you? Yes, Swami told you. Why don't you tell me? Swami started telling about all his friends, their problems, the purpose of their visit, and the details of their conversation. Tell you how we started sweating. Oh God. Because if we start telling about every one of us, well, we may feel like running away, you know. All those things, certain things, better not be revealed. So, what to be done? And then he asked, "Are boy, you have got youth wing of such an organization in Hyderabad?" Yes, Swami. Your friends belong to that youth wing. Yes, Swami. What are they doing now? That boy said, Swami, they go to hospitals, they visit jails also, they visit homes for the aged, and they go to schools and teach moral education to boys. Very good. How long? 1 month, Swami. Oho! Moral education in 1 month. Oh, very great. These boys, though they are here for number of years, they are not receiving. Can you give in 1 month moral education? This fellow says, I'm sorry, Swami. No, no, no. Then he asked, what do you mean by moral education? What do you mean by moral education? That boy said, Swami, what is good and what is bad are taught under moral education. Oho! Then what is good, what is bad? Swami, in other words, right or wrong. Oho! Then what is right, what is wrong? Until the fellow is undone. until he lifts both his hands in lift, please leave me, Swami at this stage. Then, oh, then boy said, Swami, morality. Morality. Oh, what is morality? Swami, please, I don't know. Then Swami started telling. Swami used here again four important technical Sanskrit terms which are interesting. I start sharing these things. What did you eat for lunch and what did you eat for breakfast? For that, boys, it's fine. But for us at this grown-up age, or young adults, if you want to call it, we need certain things of that carries a message, don't you think so? What are the four words that used? One word, niti, niti. Second word, riti. Second word he used, riti. And third word, khyati, khyati. Fourth word, jati. Niti, riti, khyati, jati. Four words he used. Started explaining them. All these four words come under moral education. The first, niti. Swami said, niti means truth. 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 Nothing but truth. Second, riti. Riti. Practice of truth. Practice of truth. Adherence of truth. Following the path of truth is riti. Third, khyati. Khyati, outwardly, may give the meaning, name and fame. No. Khyati is tyaga or sacrifice. Sacrifice. And fourth word, jati, human race. So, race, jati. We belong to human race, manava jati, manava jati, human race. We deserve to be members of human race if we have khyati, that is tyaga, which is sacrifice. And this sacrifice, artyaga, arkhyati, is possible if we follow the path of truth, riti. We'll be able to follow the path of truth, riti, if we know what truth is, niti. In other words, if truth, niti is known, it can be followed by riti or procedure that leads to tyaga or sacrifice, which is khyati, which is the ultimate reputation of name and fame to all of us, that befits us to be called jati or human race. Am I clear? That's what Bhagavan explained that pleasant afternoon. Then in a lighter way, he asked that boy, do you have friends? That boy could understand. Swami, I have few friends. Few friends? No, no. He asked another boy, how many friends have you? Before that boy gave reply, Swami said, you have many friends, I know. Then he said, who is your true friend? Who is your true friend? they were just thinking. Bhagavan said, God is your true friend. God is your only friend. God is your true friend. Then Swami gave a beautiful definition to this word, friend. What in English we call a friend in need is a friend indeed. In English we say, a friend in need is a friend indeed. That's what Bhagavan said. Who is a true friend? The one who will always be in your company, who will never betray you, who will never cheat you, who will never give you up, who will never give you up in times of difficulties, in times of sickness, in times of danger. He is only your true friend. Do you have any friend on earth like that? Who will never leave us? Who will be with us always, supporting us in times of difficulties and sickness? He is God. So, treat God as your true friend who will be always with you.